And now it is my great pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Laura Jane Grace, and her co-author, Dan Ozzie. As many of you already know, Laura is the front person, singer, songwriter, and guitarist for the punk rock band Against Me. And in 2012, she came out as transgender. And in fact, gender identity is a subject that she's written about a lot in her songs. But we're here tonight because of her book, which is a very painful and personal memoir entitled Tranny, a title which captures the conflict and self-loathing she's had to work through growing up and coming to terms with her female identity. Dan Ozzie is a New York-based writer, her co-writer, and he's served, among other things, as the editor of Vice's music site, Noisy. So without further ado, please join me now in welcoming to Politics and Prose, Laura Jane Grace and Dan Ozzie.
Hello.
Hey, Laura.
Hi, Dan.
How are you doing since a minute ago when we were just over there?
Fantastic.
We stole a bunch of books. Sorry. I'm supposed to be asking you questions tonight,
but I think that's how it works.
We spent a year on this book, and I literally don't think I have any more questions for you. I think I'd like to know less about you if possible.
I would also like the same.
One thing that I always was curious, though, is so much of the book, you know, we used your journals that you kept for so long as the text that we were working with. And I remember we were in Chicago. I was staying at your place, and you had to go drop off your daughter. And you said, hey, Dan, you know, I'll be right back. Just help yourself to whatever. You're the only person that I've ever not worried about reading my journals while away. But I was wondering, like, you brought those out on tour. You always had, you know, a book in your bag. Did you ever worry that somebody was going to take a peek or, you know?
I wouldn't be surprised if one of my bandmates or crewmates did do that. I actually, like, over the years had developed, like, techniques where, like, I was always paranoid someone was, like, looking over my shoulder on an airplane, so I would, like, write really sloppy or in a handwriting that I could only decipher.
But hieroglyphics.
Yeah, but I also sometimes would write something completely sensational or untrue in the journal, so if the off chance someone did open it and read in it, they would just quickly close it.
right. So. Well, can I ask, I mean, you did keep them out. Was there ever, what do you think you would have done? I don't know. I always thought, was wondering if there was ever any kind of subconscious desire to, like, not be found out, but, you know, like, you're writing very personal things down and you're just sort of, like, leaving it out. I mean, did you ever, like, almost want to show? So you really didn't tell anybody. You told Brendan Kelly of the Lawrence Arms.
Yes. No, I was terrified by the idea of someone reading my journal and finding out my secret. But I mean, for the most part, like, I kept them in a locked, like, footlocker so that no one could get to them other than, you know, the one that was, like, in progress in my bag, you know?
And you, when I came on board, you had signed the book deal a couple years before, but you just had piles of stuff, like, just piles of books and half-written things and scraps. And then so when I came on, I kind of tried to help guide you in the right direction. What was the, like, most daunting part of starting a book for you?
I guess at first it wasn't daunting, you know. To expand on that, like, I've kept journals since I was, like, 8 years old. I started doing it as a school assignment, and I got a really good grade on the first journal that I kept, and I just kept going from there.
Your first journal was about going to a concentration camp.
Yeah, when I was...
Just for the record, most kids are like, I went to the zoo today. Or it's like, today I saw death in the face.
No, it's true. I grew up a military brat, and for a period of time, like 4 years, I lived in Italy, and my father had to do a training exercise in Germany, and I was going to be out of school for a little while, so my teacher gave me the assignment of keeping a journal, and on that trip to Germany, my family took me to Dachau concentration camp, and so that was like, you know, really, really hard for me as an eight-year-old to understand what fascism was, Nazis, and the Holocaust. So journaling, you know, was a way to process that. And then also on that same trip, my little brother, who was three at the time, was hit by a truck and pinned under the wheels. So that was, again, another experience where, you know, I journaled that and I wrote about that. And journaling was just a great outlet. And especially when you're dealing with something that only, you know, that is a secret, like having a piece of paper to talk to was just like so important to me.
When you were going, so you, just for the record, to show how much work Laura did on this book, you transcribed all of the journals yourself.
I did.
Like farm that out, just like dozens of journals that you input into a computer yourself. What was the most surprising thing when you went back and read about your entire life? A lot of it was very angry, you know, like journaling. What was the most surprising thing to you when you went back and just read your whole life back?
I mean, it's like you see the cycles you were locked into. It's undeniable. You're like, okay, you know, this is obviously something I was doing as a coping mechanism, or this is like obviously a flaw that I have because it's keeps repeating, you know. So like to go there and to read through everything, it was just like undeniable and kind of broke me down, really, you know, just to realize like how long you've been depressed, how long you've been dealing with something. I just didn't really fully grasp that, but yeah, I mean, it took me a year and a half probably to go through and fully transcribe everything, and then from there it was like a lot of editing.
When you went through those, were there things in there that you had totally forgotten about? And it's almost, was it like, you know, when you look at an old photo album and you see a photo and it just totally unlocks a box in your head that had been closed for years? Was there anything that you were like, oh, I totally had forgotten about this?
Not much, really. No, I mean, you can't help but like think back to earlier tours or, you know, think back to what it was like, you know, being in the band and touring around. But I mean, it was just all there, you know. And I mean, I guess that's like a, you know, a problem I didn't have is with working on a book, where most musicians want to go back and write a memoir, they're then tasked with remembering, and I didn't have to remember anything because it was just like all there. If I was like staying in a hotel, I wrote down the hotel name, the room number. If I was on a plane, I wrote down the flight number, seat number I was in. It was just like all there in detail.
When we were writing the book, I kept saying to Laura, you know, Laura, like, when you're writing a memoir, this is how you remember it, but other, you know, the people you're writing about, they might not remember it the same way. And Laura was like, oh yeah, well, I wrote it down. So that's how it was, okay? And for the record, it's funny too, because every time there was this story that you told me that I was in charge of, sort of like, okay, I have to insert this into the book now. A lot of times, like I remember one time you told me about the first time you ever played the song Black Me Out was on New Year's Eve. And I remember you telling me, like, it just sounded so cinematic. You were like, yeah, and I played it right when it turned midnight. Nobody knew it, and I played Black Me Out, and that's when I decided I was going to transition genders. And I was like, okay, Laura. And then I went up on YouTube, and I'm like, let me see if I can find this. And I found it, and I was like, that's literally exactly how you said how it went down. So that was when I, like, started to trust your hindsight, where I was like, okay, this woman's not pulling my leg.
Thank you.
But you are going to, you've said, not to spoil, but you say in the book, and you've said before that you want to burn the journals now. I know that you feel that this book and these journals have been something that, I mean, obviously the book is a huge achievement for you, but in a way, you've told me that it feels almost like something holding you down, or holding you to a past life in a way. Is it like, what's the significance of burning them?
I mean, being done with it, you know, like after going through and rewriting it again, you know, by typing it into a computer, like, I don't want to go back and read them anymore. And part of the impetus for writing in the book in the first place was just like, not only the metaphysical weight, but just the actual physical weight of all those journals in boxes and having to haul them around everywhere I go, every time I've moved, hiding them in a closet, hoping someone doesn't find them, you know, like, so just getting rid of that. I mean, that to me, like, you know, when starting to write the book, it was like, okay, you know, I made the decision, like, right coinciding with coming out, and it seemed like, okay, and moving forward with the future, maybe the best thing to do would be to reconcile with the past. And I feel fully done with that. You know, I'm done with thinking about the past. It's all in a book.
And I feel so guilty since we finished this book, because everybody, you know, obviously, like, you did a topless shoot for Rolling Stone. Obviously, they're not asking me to be topless in it. And I just feel so guilty that, like, we worked on this book so hard together for a year every day, and now I'm pretty much done. I come here once in a while and I'm talking to a microphone, but you're the one that has to do the interviews. You have to, like, do book tours and stuff like that. And what I just felt bad about was, you know, this book literally should answer every question that anybody could possibly have about your life, so that you never have to answer questions again. And now you go on this book tour and people want to ask you more questions.
Well, it's funny too, because it's like, they're like, you know, tell us about the book. So it's like, you know, people want you to, like, paraphrase what took you 4 years to
300 pages in 1 minute. Go.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, well, just read the book. And then it's also like, you know, there's like, you know, there's the ability to create worthwhile art, and then there's the ability to give worthwhile interviews, you know, which are two separate things.
Sure.
You know, you
sure.
So it's, yeah, overwhelming sometimes, to be honest.
When Laura and I were working on this book, there was a point where we were working so hard and our whole life was looking at Google Docs, and our we kept joking about how our brains for reading and editing got so sharp that we were lending each other books and would just blow through them in, like, you know, one plane ride. You would just completely go through them. But I remember the one book that you asked me to read very early on, because it inspired you, was On the Road with the Ramones, which is sort of like an oral history of the Ramones book. And you said that you saw some parallels between the Ramones and Against Me. What was that exactly that you saw?
I mean, like, that book in particular, like, it really, like, humanized them, you know, and it just it showed the connection of, like, oh, you know, like, the Ramones are this, like, mythological band to me, you know. And reading that book, it was like, but they're kind of also just like my band. You know, they're in there talking about how they prefer staying at the Hampton Inn because the Continental Breakfast is great, you know? And it's like, yeah, yeah, the Continental Breakfast is really good at the Hampton Inn, you know? So, and like, also just like,
I love that their song, I Want to Be at the Continental Breakfast by the Ramones. They changed it to I Want to Be Sedated, but.
Right, right. And also, you know, like, with the way that book ended, how, like, the Ramones played their last show and, you know, just walked off stage and no one really said goodbye to each other and just went their separate ways. And, like, so many of the relationships I've had with other musicians who have played with them in my band, it's that way. You know, you go from spending, like, pretty much 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all year long together, to then one day just never seeing each other and never talking again. It's just, like, that immediate and that cut off.
What other, I remember you, when we talked early on also, you said that you were inspired by the Henry Rollins' Get in the Van. What other, like, what was it about that book, and what other books did you have in your head that you kind of emulated?
Well, Get in the Van, obviously, because it's like, you know, it's kind of journal-based, you know, and it's talking about touring in a punk rock band, and I've toured in a punk rock band since I was 20 years old. I'm 26 now.
You look fantastic.
Thank you, Dan.
You do. You look great.
And then another was Sartre's War Journals. And he really talked about the importance of journaling.
The famous rock biography, Sartre's War Journals.
And then Candy Darling's diary. That was another one as well.
What was it about those that, like, you felt a connection?
Just the intimacy of it, and that it didn't hold anything back, you know? And like, specifically with journaling, like, and with basing a book off of journals, you know, I didn't, like, when I was journaling, it wasn't like, I'm going to write about what a great day I had, you know, or how nice this person was to me. It was like, I'm going to put my fears in here and write about, like, you know, what is troubling me. So like reading that in other books, like I could identify with that, you know, and that was what I wanted to do with this book.
There, for the record, there was never a part that Laura and I were working and Laura said, you know, we can't put that in, or I don't want that in the book, or we have to soften this. It was just like very much, this is how it is. All right, put it in there. And I always wondered how, I mean, for me, like, I was joking the other night, we did an event in New York and I had a lot of friends and family there. And I was joking, I was like, man, this book rocks. I really hope my friends and family read it. And Laura's like, yeah, this book rocks. I hope my friends and family never read this book ever. But like, I that wasn't something that I was very much thinking about when we were working on it, like how people were going to interpret it. I just wanted to make the best book that we possibly could. But obviously in the back of your mind, you're thinking of how ex-wives and former bandmates and fans would react to this book. Did that like hinder the work on it, or has that been weighing on you now that it's out? Or
I mean, it's interesting, and I was talking about this the other night where like someone asked me like, oh, have you given copies to your friends or your family? And I was like, no, I haven't given anyone a copy of the book. I mean, like, I joke with my mom, or well, I wasn't joking, she jokes, where I'm like do not read the book, and she's like, I'm gonna go to Barnes and Noble, I'm gonna get the book. And I'm like, please don't do it. But, you know, with the book, it's like there are a lot of things in here that I'm not proud of that were a part of my experience, you know. So you're out here and you're trying to, like, promote something you made, but I don't want it to ever seem like I'm, like, bragging, like, here, check it out, I'm so awesome, you know. But there was something related to this that I wanted to talk about with you, which I brought up the other night. So this is an incident. So you know, you do have to cut some things when you have like 1.5 million words, right?
I'm so curious to see where this is going.
Okay, yeah. So I'm gonna just read a quick part of this book, right? Okay, and this is talking about in freshman year of high school, I got in a fight. So one of the most violent encounters was with a member of the football team who loved to bully kids like me, although I brought this one on by myself by teasing him about shaving his legs. As if from a John Hughes movie, the jock threatened to kick my ass after school. 3 p.m. in the hallway, he said, be there or I'll fine you. I showed up, but before I could even say a word or do anything, his friend charged up behind me and clocked the side of my head, knocking me to the ground. I landed next to some paint cans by a janitor's closet. I picked one up and started swinging with everything I had. I hit them as many times as I could. In between punches, they landed on me while kids cheered on. An administrator came by and everyone scattered. I left the building and ran across the street toward the mall while the jocks got in their car to hunt me down. My face swollen, I hid behind a dumpster in the parking lot until it got dark. So that's the story in the book, right?
Tell everybody the part that I made you cut out of that.
The truth is that I was on acid when that fight happened. I didn't want to cut that. I was like, I was on acid. We should, yeah, we should put that in there.
That was just a continuity thing where we hadn't mentioned that you had started drugs yet, so it got like really confusing. But I was like, man, that is a sweet part.
So that wasn't like a censoring, like, oh, don't let anyone know I was taking acid freshman year of high school. But as you said, it was like a continuity thing.
Right, right. Yeah. Just assume most of the parts in the book were on acid and that we were on acid while writing it. That's a fair assumption.
I also filled out a police report while on acid after the fight happened, which was the most interesting encounter with a police officer I've ever had.
Everybody's like tweeting it. This just in, Laura cuts out drug use. Well, I asked you once you know, when you kept saying like, oh Christ, I hope my mom doesn't read this. I kept asking you like, what specifically is it that you're worried about her finding out? And you said the drug use specifically, that you didn't think she knew maybe the extent to the drug use, like she knew it was present, but not that. So like, how do you think she'll take that?
I mean, as a parent, like, I don't want to ever read about my child going through a hard time or experiencing trauma, you know, or dealing with something for that many years, or feeling like they don't have anyone to turn to, you know, other than a diary. So, I don't know. My mom's supposed to come to the book event tomorrow, possibly. And I'm
just
like,
mysteriously not on the list.
Yeah, Mom, I don't know. I put you down.
I was like, security. But yeah, I just like, I feel like I know if she comes, like, that she'll cry and then I'll cry. So, you know, that's, I don't know.
I'll make you cry right now.
I cry easy.
When I've heard you talk about writing the book, like, I just read an interview today on Fast Company or something like that. Obviously, because you're such an astute businesswoman, Fast Company would cover you. But you make it sound like writing this book was such a remarkably unpleasant experience, because a lot of it was painful to look back, and I totally understand that. Was there anything that you enjoyed about the process of writing this book?
Finishing.
What was the best part? What was your favorite part about working with me? What would you say? What was the best part about working with me? I got that. Nailed it. Obviously a lot has been made of the title, and that was something that you suggested, and I was like, yeah, I'm 100% behind you on that. I get it. Obviously, some people, I saw some like chatter online. A lot of people thought that was your choice and right to do that. A lot of people thought that was a word that they didn't want to see perpetuated anymore. And, you know, when we were in the middle of the book, I was on such a like reporter brain where you're just like taking things factually. That's the title. We're incorporating that in. But then as soon as we finished, I stepped out and looked at it, and I was like, holy shit. Like, that's terrible. And I remember just having this, think, you know, I had tweeted about we wrote the book and I put the title in there, but then after that I just started thinking, as like a hetero male identifying dude, like I don't really feel comfortable saying that word. And I asked you, I was like, do you think when I talk about it and tweet about it and whatever, I should maybe censor that? And you were just like, I don't know. Like, and it made me kind of think, like, well, I think what's cool about the title is it forces everybody to make that choice. You know, it made me think about it, and it made me feel like I don't feel comfortable saying that word, and I'm not going to. You know, like, that's factually the title of the book, but I don't feel comfortable doing that. Do you hope that it does that for people? I mean, when I did an interview about you for Esquire, and so they were asking me about the title, and I said, you know, when I grew up, my parents would like beat the hell out of me if I used a number of words, the N-word, obviously, the homophobic F-word, that was just like, you were not ever allowed to use those words, but like the T-word was not one of those. And I think it's just because, like, at the time when I grew up in the early 2000s, no, JK, in the 80s, that was not a topic that was really in mainstream culture enough for it to be like a taboo word. Do you hope that by naming the book, you're pushing that word into the conversation, and maybe, you know, when I have kids, it'll be like, you know, they won't be allowed to use that word.
Yeah. I mean, I want to make it clear that I hate the word. You know, like, I don't identify with the word. I don't want to be called that word. I don't like want to hear other people call that word. I don't use the word. But just because it's an ugly word doesn't mean that it's not a fitting title for a book. And it is a complicated word, because especially people in the trans community, you know, there's many people in an older generation of trans people who reclaimed that word, you know, and would use it freely. And it was a word that used to hold a lot of power over me, and that I was like terrified of the way I would respond the first time someone used it in reference to me. And I really had to think about, you know, how will I react? What will I do? And then the first time someone ever called me that, it was another trans person who was like jokingly, you know, just like not saying it derogatorily towards me, which just really like kind of stunned me, where I was like, huh, interesting. But I do hope it creates dialogue, you know, and I do hope it makes people think. But again, like, just because something is an ugly word doesn't mean it's not a fitting title. And I know it's a cliche, but don't judge a book by its cover. Read the book and maybe you'll understand. I mean, so much of this book is about internalized transphobia, self-hate, self-loathing, and dealing with that. So in that way, you know, it's a fitting title.
But also, like, you're almost forcing people to use it if they're talking about it. And I mean, I'm just curious to you, does it bother you when you see online or in person, when you see, you know, cis people or whatever, say that word, just like, oh, I got my copy of signed. Does that bother you just seeing that people hear it? And then do you feel responsible for putting it out in the world?
It's mentally taxing. Mm-hmm. Yes. Uh-huh. But at the same time, you know, like, I would love it. I mean, if you like, if you Google that word, you know, I'll tell you what comes up. I would love it if instead, if you Google that word, just my book came up and was it, you know? But yeah, it's, yeah.
So I'm going to take audience questions in just 1 second. I just wanted to ask you, lastly, you know, so Laura and I wrote the first 12 chapters, and then we had to write one more, and the publisher was like, hey, you two sending that chapter in, that last chapter? We're like, we're working on it. Like, you know, clicking keys in the background. I'm like, right now.
Yeah, the part of writing a book is learning the art of stalling and buying yourself time.
So that last chapter took us a long, long time to get it right because, you know, you went through this whole, a bit of an existential crisis. Like, you're like, I'm not dead yet. how do I finish a book? How do I finish my story?
And my band didn't break up. You know?
Right, like, yeah, yeah. There's no climactic moment that you can, like, tie this ending to. And you had a real, like, what does it all mean type of thing. Like, what were you thinking about at that time when you were, like, trying to wrap up your life story? I'm sure you had very deep, like, what does my life mean type of thoughts.
Well, I mean, I guess that the answer is kind of in that. It's like, you know, that I don't want this to just be my life story. I just want it to be a part of my life. And I wanted to, like, have the ability to go on living my life and to not be turned into, like, a character. Because, you know, the book's true. It's the truth. But also, like, there's a lot more to it. Of course, there's a lot more to life, you know?
Yeah. I remember we wrote it up to your transition. And then after your transition, we tried to, like, keep going. And it was like, you know, we were just writing about band minutia. And we were like, why isn't this interesting? And it's like, oh, well, because we crossed the thing. Like, it's like a magician who gave away his trick and now is, like, doing card tricks, you know? Like, it was just didn't make sense. So we were just like, well, cut this. So we, like, cut a whole chapter out of it. I mean, and then it ends with your daughter, largely, who's 7 now and is very adorable. but one day she will be old enough to read the book. How do you think that she'll take a lot of the awful stuff that was in it?
I don't know, you know? I do know, though, that, you know, my parents, when I was younger, didn't really talk to me about drugs or anything like that. They didn't have a book about their exploits or anything.
No?
No. But I still found my way to it, you know? So I think the important thing is just having a dialogue and talking about it and being open. And I mean, even if I wouldn't have written a book, there's still, like, 7 records worth of songs talking about these same things. And there's countless interviews I've given or, you know, or other people that'll talk about me, you know, that are out there. So, like, you know, it's part of an explanation, I guess.
Yeah. Do we want to maybe take some audience questions if we have some?
Cool. I think they want you to go to the microphone or that microphone right there.
Step up to one of the microphones.
Can I go first?
Do it.
Go for it. We're all waiting now.
All right, then. Is this close enough? I'm bad at microphones.
Doing great.
I'm not an expert here. All right, first of all, I think it's pretty funny how book tour Laura has much neater hair than music tour Laura.
A lot less sweaty, too.
Makes sense, yeah, uh-huh. Yeah. So my question is basically, so I got into the music after you came out. I didn't know about Against Me before that, so I was kind of retroactive. And I noticed several songs, especially the last 2 songs on White Crosses, or I guess Black, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
About that I think are about the anarchist community, right? One by One and Bitter Divisions.
Oh, okay. That's like the special edition version of that record. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh. So those two, basically, when I heard them as about the trans community, because I've been a part of it, and it reminds me. So how many parallels have you noticed between the two communities now that you've experienced both, I guess, is my question.
Or like parallels, what kind of parallels between that punk community and
yeah,
the
punk
trans
anarchist community.
community
and the trans community.
I guess, you know, that there's oftentimes unfortunate infighting in both. Mm-hmm. That's really counterproductive and, mm-hmm. you know, chatter on the internet.
Yeah. Okay.
When you came up with that title, I mean, you knew right away that you were going to take shit for it online, and sure enough, like, you did get some of that too, but
that idea is like infuriating to me. If the idea is someone's like, okay, I support you as a trans person, oh, but now you've said a word I don't like, I don't support you anymore, then to me it's immediately like, well, fuck you, I'm gonna use the word.
And the same thing, but I feel like your punk background prepared you, because it was the same thing. It was like, oh, I'm in a punk band, oh, but you signed to this slightly larger label, why, well, fuck you now. And you kind of had to deal with that again. Were there parallels that you felt like you were seeing the same patterns?
To some extent, yeah, for sure. Again, it's like all like pretty internet based, you
right,
know, like
right. Fucking internet.
Never, don't read the comments.
So a lot of your songs before you came out, such as like The Ocean and Pretty Girls the Mover, how does that feel now, getting able to play and sing those songs on stage after versus before, and like just the emotional release of that?
It feels like people have the right context, you know. I mean, that was something that like became more and more like overwhelming to me, is like being on stage and like feeling like I didn't know who I was, and I didn't feel like the audience knew who I was, and that they were taking what I was saying right, you know. And so having people understand where it's coming from and what you're saying, I think is more gratifying.
Thank you.
On this side.
Oh. Hi, Laura.
Hi.
I'll bypass asking you if it makes you feel uncomfortable for strangers to feel like they know you on such an intimate level.
I understand.
Sure,
it. I totally understand it. No, I totally get it.
But with that as context, so my relationship with your music has always led me to understand that you create it like super incessantly and almost involuntarily, and the book actually framed it in such a way that it seemed very deliberate. And so I saw you cover the song Shivers, and I think that's the first time I heard Black Me Out. And okay. It seemed so much like something that just sort of happened. And again, I apologize that people feel like they know you so well just by that relationship. But how did that just happen? Like, how did you capture such lightning in a bottle with like Black Me Out at that same exact time deliberately? Like, it just seems like you always are creating music and that you can't help it, but it was so interesting to hear that like you were like, yeah, now I have to write music now.
I mean, I wish there was a formula to it, you
right.
know, like, but songwriting is hard, and oftentimes you like, you know, I always tell people who ask for advice with writing songs, it's like, everyone thinks they suck. You know, I still think I'm terrible at guitar, I'm terrible at writing songs, you know. But you, like, kind of got to go for volume. And, like, oftentimes, it's like, you know, like, you know, write a lot. But, yes, turn it up loud, too. But yeah, I mean, like, sometimes it's easy, you know, sometimes you have those moments where it's like, you feel like it was a gift where it just like came to you from the ether, and here's like a fully formed song that just came. And other times it's just like pulling nails, you know, and you're just like day after day revising something, or like, you know, feeling insecure about something. So unfortunately there's not a formula other than, you know, you gotta put that pen to paper.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's it.
Hi. So I've only been out as trans for almost a year, but I was wondering, since your transition, how have you noticed the trans community change, especially over the past few years? Because I've noticed even just recently that it's been evolving and just everyone's awareness has been increasing a lot.
Well, there's been so much more of a visibility. I mean, so many moments like over the past couple years I've witnessed where I've thought, I never thought I would be seeing this happen. You know, whether that was Laverne Cox on the cover of Time magazine, or seeing the Attorney General say that the Obama administration recognizes transgender people and has their back. You know, I mean, that was like mind bending to me. I just like, you know, never thought that would happen. And I think that is like, you know, you have those tipping point moments where when I was younger, there was just so little information and there was nowhere to go, you know, and this is like in a pre-internet era and there was like nothing at the library or anything like that. So anytime you saw something that was like a positive trans story, like I always took it as like a sign from the universe, like telling me like that I had to come out, you know, or like pushing me in a path. And I think when you have enough visibility, like then you have the same thing happening for other people where it's speaking to them and you realize like what's possible.
Thank you.
That was a great question.
So writing the book and kind of being on tour, do you think that helped during the writing process, being on tour and being able to have that distraction of going out on stage? And did the tour kind of did writing the book you know, bring any music out of you and stuff like that? Like how did those two kind of go with each other?
Yes and no. You know, from when I started, like got a book deal or whatever to finish was like 4 years time, and like right in the middle, I was like, I was like, I'm done with this. You know, like I was originally working with a different publisher and they weren't liking what I was doing with it. And I didn't like what they were suggesting I do with it. And so I was like, you know what? If the deal goes away, it goes away. I don't care anymore. But then it ended up working out in the end. As far as like, it was odd though, like, you know, we had a record come out this year in September. And I think the only reason there is like a new Against Me record that quick was because I was doing the book at the same time. And it took all the pressure off of songwriting. Whereas before, like songwriting and shows were my main thing that I had to be focusing on. Mm-hmm. Now it was, okay, you're focusing on writing a book. And then it was like, well, you know, we really should be working on this chapter that the publisher wants, but maybe I'll just pick up my guitar and write a song instead.
I did not like that part.
Awesome.
Cool.
We also, though, I just started to jump in. I think from my perspective, like I think your tour life also sort of helped and informed the writing of the book, just because I remember 2 weeks before the book was due, North Carolina passed that bullshit fucking HB2 law, and you went to North Carolina and burned your birth certificate on stage, and like you were trending on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And it was at that like that, I feel like literally reignited our like passion for the book, because it was just like a great, we were working on it for like a year and we're just in it and it was like work. But at that moment, it was like, oh my God, we're almost done with this book. And this is like important. Like right. This is a really timely and important book. And it sort of like put the onus back on us to not fuck it up, you know, to make sure it was good. And I feel like in a way, like, the real world at the time when you were on tour like really helped the book in a way.
Right. And then like, you know, earlier this year too, I did like a solo tour, and there was a show here in DC at the historic Six and I Synagogue. And you know, part of that was like, I'm just like, I'm so burnt on sitting in front of a computer working on this, and I wanted to go out and be able to like read a journal entry and play a song and feel if there was a reaction immediately from people and see what worked and what didn't. And that was like really useful.
Speaking of sitting at your computer, can I blow up your spot for something that has never been said publicly?
No, turn the mic off. No.
Laura didn't get a computer until a month before we were finished with the book.
No, that's not true.
You didn't own a laptop
no,
that worked.
Well, it just wouldn't connect to the internet. That was all.
So I remember we were like the last, we were finishing up. And you had like an Apple like box. You were like, look what I bought. I was like, cool.
Well, I had an iPad and I got a little keyboard for the iPad so I could work on the Word file from that. You
right,
know, like,
right.
But yeah.
Well, I'm glad you finally got a notebook for your next book. Thanks. Which, where were we on here, right? Hi.
Yeah. You actually kind of already like touched on this a little bit, but I know that a lot of people, including myself, including like people that I know, see you as like this role model or like this person of interest within the transgender and the LGBT community. How does that make you feel to have that like spotlight on you? Like when people say your name in the community, people know who you are.
It's a lot of pressure.
I mean,
I try to tell people all the time, like, I don't have all the answers and I'm a really imperfect person when it comes down to it, you know? And I'm guaranteed to disappoint you if you think otherwise. And that was like, you know, a part of why it took so long with the book too, is like, you know, coming out, especially coming out publicly, had its advantages and disadvantages. On the one hand, like being like, okay, you know, I have this Rolling Stone article that I can just give to friends and be like, here, read this on your own, digest it. You know, if there's any questions, you can ask me, but this should pretty much answer. It was great. But then at the same time, like having to come out in that way where it was like, okay, I have to know all the answers. And then I have to like really stick to them because like it's going to be representing a community. Like that's just unrealistic pressure when you're coming out. And I had a nervous breakdown like a year and a half into it, and that was like after already signing a book deal too. So it was like, okay, I signed this book deal and the publishers want this happy ending because you're supposed to be doing positive trans stories or something like that, and like I could no longer give that because like my life had fallen apart and I had fallen apart as a person and my like foundation for transitioning was like destroyed. So it was like, well, how do I communicate that, you know? But I think what's important always is just being real, being honest, and the truth always resonates more.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I just want to say how surreal it is to be talking at a normal volume and not screaming from the pit. I just want to say when I first heard The Ocean, my friends and I are all sitting around and we got to that lyric where you were talking about if you were born a woman, and we all kind of looked at each other. And I think at that moment we were like, okay, but that was kind of unusual. And then I heard on the internets that you were transitioning, and I felt at that moment, and I'm ashamed to say it, I was like, oh my God, his voice, he cannot change his voice. And looking back on that now, I have to apologize for being the cisgender asshole, because that was so selfish of me. And, you know, we all have things we go through in our lives. And at that moment, I look back on that and I wrote a whole Facebook post about, oh my God, I hope he doesn't lose his voice. I just cannot understand how that would happen. And I look back on that now and I just have to apologize because your music has taken a whole new level for me. And I just, you know, greatly appreciate it.
Right on. So, well, I mean, first of all, like when you play like 200 plus shows a year and you're screaming every night, you cannot control what happens to your voice.
That's true. Like, and I can't control it from not getting shaky right now. Like I said, it's kind of surreal, but I just have to say, since that time, close friends, close family have had, because they heard me talking about it, have shared things with me and their transition. And it just totally opened my eyes. So. It does make a personal difference.
Can I just add to that? Would you mind if I just, we said it in Brooklyn the other night when we had an event. Like, for me personally, as just like a cis dude working with you on this book, obviously it's been great getting to know you over the last few years, but also like to me the best part about working on this book is having met a lot of your fans who are trans or genderqueer and just learning from them. Like I talk to them online sometimes if they like email me or tweet at me or if I meet them in person, and it's been such a helpful thing to just like learn from you and this like great community that you have. And I just feel like over the last few years we've made a lot of progress as a society, and I think there's all this shit that we're conditioned to think about ourselves that we're all trying to unlearn right now, you know? Like we've had it in our heads that this is the way things are with gender or identities, and we're just trying to unlearn all that shit together. And like I feel like this book has helped me so much, not that just that it's out, but just like meeting people and just like being in these crowds where there's this community of people, and it feels so fucking good that we're all moving forward, because like we're in for a really shitty 4 years coming up, and like Laura's birthday was on the election day, so just think about that.
Worst birthday ever.
So like I know that it just sucks. It sucks that we're in for this, but it feels so cool that we're like all fucking fighting together. And like for me, like it doesn't affect me personally, but it very much does, because like I know all these people who it will affect very personally. And you know, like I guess I'm just trying to say thank you all for like helping me and other people unlearn the shit that we've been conditioned to think.
I mean, I really think that's what it comes down to. It is education. You know, like if you all think back to like sex ed class in high school and what a joke that was, you know, there was no like gender studies class, and there was no like, you know, people don't realize the separation between gender identity and sexual identity, you know? And when it comes down to it, talking about like the next 4 years or whatever, like you know, the gains that have been made in progress for trans people have come at the expense of so many trans lives, you know, and it's not like, you know, you're coming from like, oh, it was great, you know, like there's still just so many issues and so much more progress to be made for equal rights that work just needs to continue on, you know.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Over here.
Hi.
Hey.
Huge fan.
Thanks.
It's actually convenient that you brought that up, because that's kind of what I wanted to ask about. You know, I didn't think we could leave here without at least saying something about the election. So this comes out as at a really important time. And I know that since last Wednesday morning, there's been some discussion about soul searching on the left and perhaps if we push too far on certain issues. And I think I even read one person say you can't win on social justice platforms. And it's like, F that, you know, but how
I agree.
How do we now respond to that kind of argument and ensure that that's not going to be the future of the left is kind of just saying, all right, we got this far and that's how far we're going
to
get.
I mean, you just have to continue to speak out, you know, don't be quiet, refuse to be silenced, you know, and yeah, protest, you know.
Remember right before the election, Bill Maher said something about how we need to, like, the number one goal has to be defeating Trump, and we need to push boutique issues like transgender rights to the side for a moment. Fuck Bill Maher for saying that. Seriously, fuck that. Like, I don't know. Sorry. That, like, made me so fucking furious, because it was right when we were, like, finishing up, too, and I was like, yes, sorry. Hi. So, thank you.
Hi, Laura.
Hey.
So, huge fan.
Thanks.
Actually, I want to thank you because definitely through your documentary was actually something that gave me the courage to eventually come out. So, a big thank you. You're like a hero.
Right
so,
on.
I have a big question, and it's kind of more relating to your daughter okay. and your relationship to her. I know that you talk a lot about, like, internalized transphobia. And for me, like, I beat myself up 10 to 20 times worse than society or what I thought other people would do is the self-hatred. And I think one of my biggest struggles was worrying, you know, like, oh crap, like I'm not gonna be the dad that my daughter deserves, or, you know, like she's gonna be missing something. And I was just curious, like, did you ever struggle with that internalized transphobia with your daughter, and how did you overcome that?
Completely struggled with that, very much so. And, like, you know, looking back on it now, you know, I mentioned, like, I had a complete suicidal nervous breakdown. And I really think that, like, a really important part of transitioning was that, where having been socialized male and grown up that way, like, having to destroy your male ego mm-hmm. to then move on and grow from that.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Right on.
Thanks. Over here.
Hi. Big fan, Laura. And Dan, your Twitter account's really funny.
Thanks.
So I tend to journal myself, but sadly I've thrown a lot of things out because I think about the times I've gone through, and it's really cringeworthy and embarrassing, and I throw everything out. Did you ever, before you actually transcribed anything, did you ever go back to any of your journals that you had already written?
No.
Never.
No, I really didn't. I usually, like, would divide journals between, like, okay, this is, like, the journal entry part and this is, like, the lyric right. part. So sometimes I would go back for, like, lyric stuff or whatever, but I really didn't go back over the years and, like, okay. reread as I was going, no.
Okay, that was my question.
Right on.
Hi.
Hi.
So my question was kind of inspired by what you were talking about, who you want to read this and who you don't want to read this, and I kind of want to know how much of writing the book was for you to get something out there and to move, like, past those journals and past that experience, and how much of it was to share that experience, because I felt like my impression so far had been that it was, like, a personal matter and that having a book of all of that together would be, like, really cathartic. But then you said doing the Sixth and I events, you're kind of trying to see, like, reactions to what worked and didn't work. Like, how much of it was for having a book for other people to read, and how much of it was for you, and how that influenced the process and whether you wrote the book in the first place?
I really think, you know, for the most part, it was for the selfish reasons, you know, and a lot of that has to do with, like, you know, my definition of success is the completion of it, you know, is like, this is a success because it exists, you know, and that was the point. I want to write a book, and now there's the book. Whatever happens afterwards is beyond my control. So that's, like, the most important part. That's the reason for doing it.
Okay. this is, if you guys don't mind a follow up, would you consider writing?
One and done. No, okay, I'm sorry.
Do you feel like someone who would want to write a book for book writing purposes, like go out and, you know, explore that beyond journals or?
I mean, yeah, but like what is book writing purposes? Well, like I was thinking a lot about this where like, cause like I did an interview earlier today where like the journalist is like, so why did you decide to write a book? And it's like, I don't know. You know, like just like I was compelled to, you know, like where it's like, does every author get asked that? Like, do musicians get that? Why does anyone do anything? Why do you create art? You know, like it's an odd question sometimes, really, when you think about it, you know?
Yeah, I think it might come between the comparison of like memoir versus like I'm going to write a fiction where I want to create a world or something. Or
you're going to write that sci-fi novel, right, that you were talking about?
Yeah.
Star Wars fanfic that you were saying?
Well, I was saying last night, I was like, you know, talking to her, I was like, my earliest memories are of gender dysphoria and Star Wars. So, like,
Thank you so much.
Oh, sorry. Very nervous, very excited. Glad I stood up.
Must be so daunting to meet me in person, I would imagine.
Dan, it's an honor. So not to get a little too personal in the question, but as a very closeted, non-binary person who has greatly realized my transness through your work, whether it's through Against Me or the True Trans miniseries or whatnot, I have a bit of a double-edged question. A, any advice for someone who's just way at the beginning of transition, way at the beginning of no idea how I'm going to, you know, no idea about how to come out or when or any of those things. And based on your experiences with transitioning and coming out, would you have changed anything about the way you did it?
I mean, you know, first of all, like, it's important to know when coming out, like, it's okay to, like, belly flop into it, you know, and you shouldn't feel like you're, like, asking permission or apologizing for yourself, you know? And then, like, while I had this idea of like, and this is who I want to become and this is who I hope to be, like chances are that won't be who you'll end up being, like, and you don't have to have it all figured out. I had a therapist who used this metaphor of like, you know, just because you're diagnosed with cancer doesn't make you an expert on cancer. So just because you're trans doesn't mean you know everything about being trans, and that's okay. Like, you don't have to have it all figured out, and you'll learn as you go.
I remember when we first started the book, we were sitting in Michigan and I was like, hey, not to sound like an idiot, but what is the difference between transsexual and transgender? And you're like, I don't know, let's Google it. And I'm like working on this giant important book and we're sitting there literally Googling, what is transgender? So yeah, you don't know everything right away for sure is what I learned from this. Thank you for that great question, that was awesome.
Thank you. Purely just because someone else did a slight jumping off point on their question. Do you think you would have changed anything after learning what you've learned? Do you think if you know, had a time machine, would you go back and change anything? Or are you happy with...
I feel like I'd drive myself nuts if I thought about that, you know? Like, it just is the way it is, and that's what happened. And, you know, like, whatever mistakes I've made, I've learned from, you know?
Thank you so much.
Right, so we'll take this one and then we'll finish these folks here and then we'll just wrap up. Hi.
Hey. Hi, Laura. Hi. I want to say very, very nervous right now.
Don't be nervous.
So not to get again too personal like other people have, but you know, I've kind of been dealing with a lot of the struggles for the past few years and coming out with people in the last few months, been on hormones for like 2 months, and I still struggle with stuff every day. What would you say to somebody who's very early in their transition about and still struggling with themselves about, is this who they really want to be and is this who they really are?
Jeez. I mean,
I know that's putting a lot on you, but I'm...
No, but it's, you know, like, I still struggle. Like, I still struggle all the time, you know? You just got to take things day by day, you know, really. Like, I try to really live in the present. And you don't have to have it all figured out, you know? And you shouldn't feel like... Like, for a long time, I felt like I was going from box A to box B, and it's like, fuck a box, you know? Like, you shouldn't have to measure up to anyone else's ideas of who you are or what gender should mean.
Okay. Thanks again, and I just want to say your music, especially Transgender Dysphoria Blues, helped me out a lot. It's one of those, I knew it was a good album when it came out, and then as I slowly started to realize who I was, it very started to hit home.
So right on.
Thanks again.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. Hi.
I realize I don't actually have a question.
Cool.
I just have statements. I had no idea about your existence until you came out and until Transgender Dysphoria Blues. And the title song has become, like, when I have a terrible day, when everyone has called me he in the entire day, I'll just go, you know what I need? Blast song. And it's just, thank you.
Right on, thank you.
And also, hilariously weird fact that I discovered is apparently I'm 5 days less than 10 years younger than you. Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Thank you for that question where you called Laura old. That was great. I like that a lot. Thank you for that. Well, does everybody want to go around and say how much older Laura is? 3 years for me. Hi, last question.
Okay. Hey, Laura. Hey. This question, it's kind of like, I haven't read the book yet, so please forgive me. I fully intend to, so if you cover this in the book, apologize. But I was wondering what it was like when you were in your band and you were kind of coming out and your bandmates' reactions and things like that. I kind of dealt with that a little bit. I was like in a super like heavy industrial band. And when it came out, they weren't like really happy. Eventually we broke up and they were kind of weirded out by me. And I was wondering like what were your bandmates like and like how did you go about doing that?
Right on. Well, my band, they were really supportive. But I think for that like stuff dawned on them where they realized like, oh, you know, like that's why you acted that way. Or like, you know, small stuff where like Andrew used to play bass in my band. Like he used to do this thing before we'd go on stage. We'd be like, all right, boys, let's go do this. And like slap everyone on the back. And every time it was just like, you know, like it would put me in such a bad mood. But he had no idea, you know, so like, having realizations like that or like, you know, with song lyrics too, I think it just like it dawned on them.
Cool.
Right on.
One of the things that you put into the last chapter of the book, which really like kind of opened my eyes about what you're talking about was, you know, as a fan who was just watching the band sort of like implode at that time, like Andrew was leaving, Jay was leaving. I remember, you know, you said something in the book about like, well, when you transition, it's not just your body that's sort of like writing itself, it's your life too. And, you know, people came in and out of your life and it wasn't that they were unsupportive or transphobic. It was just that like your transition was kind of like writing your life, you know, like stabilizing it. And I was just wondering if you thought that like, if you had been born, you know, the woman that you wanted to be, like, do you think maybe you would have even been in a band with a bunch of dudes with beards and party dudes, you know, like, do you, like, I, how do you think your life would have been different? Would you even be in a band at all? You know, was that band a result of the aggression that you needed to get out, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I have no idea. I don't know. Like,
great place to end.
but it did really, like, you know, it did, like, kick off a lot of change in my life that had nothing to do again with people being transphobic. Like I had a tree fall through the roof of a studio that I had built.
Those goddamn transphobic
tree,
trees.
Like, yeah, the tree wasn't like reacting to anything. It just like all of a sudden life changed. It felt like something was like unlocked and then everything shifted.
Well, that's it for us. The book is called, well, I don't want to say it, but here it is. So I think Laura's going to stick around to sign. Thank you all, and thank you to Politics and Prose so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for having us.
So I guess we'll start signing in a bit, and you can all get your books autographed. Cool.